Started in about 5 minutes. We're just going to be streaming live, of course, as always. Welcome to the Henry Jackson Society. We have an interesting discussion today on trends in MENA textbooks, increasing moderation and remaining radicalism, which I think gives a very interesting pointer towards the conclusions, if you like, of what we might be discussing. However, to get us to that point, we are, of course, very pleased to see our old friend Marcus Sheff, who is CEO of Impact SE. Impact SE is a research and policy nonprofit that analyzes textbooks, employing standards on peace and tolerance as derived from international declarations and resolutions. It's done sterling work across the world in examining textbooks for issues like radicalism and radicalization, and what you would hope to find in textbooks. And Marcus is a world expert. He's briefed at many places: the White House, National Security Council, U.S. State Department, Congress, UN, European Parliament, in the British Parliament, many other places as well, and a regular on the news covering this and other topics. Marcus, it's a great pleasure to welcome you to the conversation. We will have the discussion, following which Q&A is open to other people, of course. So let's make a start. Marcus, over to you.
Thank you so much, Alan, for the kind introduction. And thank you for the important work that the Henry Jackson Society does. It's been such a pleasure to have worked with you over the last year or two on the couple of reports that we did together. And frankly, always in awe of you, your organization, and how you make sense of the world as you are doing now during this international crisis and the Russian invasion of Ukraine. So thank you during that for making the time for our subject. Hopefully we will take minds off that terrible crisis just for a moment. And as you say, we are a research and policy organization. For 25 years now, we have been analyzing education to encourage standards of peace and of tolerance as derived by those declarations. We drive policy debate around the world based on our reports. And in relation to those standards, they are respect for the other, for the individual other, gender and LGBTQ equality, no hate, which you would imagine would be obvious, but in the Middle East, frankly not. Peacemaking as the way to resolve conflict, economic prosperity, and historical accuracy. And we look at all textbooks through the same prism. Really every single book. So we don't cherry pick. We understand the whole curriculum, and by using the same methodology, we can essentially gather a corpus of work and therefore a greater understanding of what is going on in the region. But you know, also we can get trend lines. If we look at textbooks over a period of years, we understand if there are shifts and where those shifts are going. And you know, the question is always why? Why textbooks? And I think we know what the answer is. We understand that school education is by far the most powerful tool to puncture extremist influences. Curricula are also the key to achieving tolerant, open-minded, peaceful societies of the future. And this is because they are uniquely authoritative. And, you know, the Middle East is not Britain, it is not America, it is not France. There is, in the Middle East, outside of Israel, one textbook per grade and per subject. So they are, you know, uniquely authoritative in that sense. They carry the seal of the state with them. Often they are only, you know, one of a few books that might be in the home. And so children and families understand very, very clearly that, you know, they convey the political, the social values that the ruler wants to impart into the next generation. And it is that power that they have, that power against radicalization, but also the power to create those societies of the future, which is, you know, so interesting to us. And of course, and finally, they are political predictors. What children are being taught today in classrooms in the Middle East will very much give us an idea of what those societies will look like in a few years' time. And so having said that, you know, I want to start with good news. And there is quite a bit of good news in relation to improvements taking place in Middle East textbooks. Let's start with Saudi Arabia. And, you know, we were following the Saudi curriculum in way back in 2003 and then in 2008. And it was a, you know, hardcore Wahhabi curriculum. We had another go in 2019. There were some changes, but really dozens of examples of, you know, offending material of hate, which needed to be removed. This report got a great deal of publicity. It was covered by the American media. And of course, the State Department has always been very focused on the Saudi curriculum after 9/11. 15 of those 19 terrorists were educated in Saudi schools. But what was interesting this time was that the Saudis were responsive and they made contact. They wanted to know not just what was in the report, but the list of examples that we show of where the problems are. We did another report in 2020 following that contact, and they had made significant improvements. Much of the hate, the incitement, the anti-Semitic, the anti-Israel material had been removed, as well as the jihad and the homophobic material. So, you know, it's not perfect. There is a lot of change which still needs to be made, but it was, I think, you know, quite remarkable that the Saudis had gone to this effort. And of course, we can talk about why, but the fact is they had made those changes in the space of actually 3 months. King Abdullah of Jordan, I think is another example of somebody who is a textbook reformer. He reformed the curriculum in 2014. This, of course, after his own understanding of what happened in 9/11, the Amman letter that he wrote of 2004, the conference of 2005. He said then that textbooks were the issue, and they were written in Jordan, as they are in so many countries in the region, by the Muslim Brothers. He made sure that changes were made and that a more inclusive, tolerant set of textbooks, particularly in respect to how Islam and other religions are portrayed, were produced. And so, you know, Islamic education is conservative, but it's moderate. Diversity is a central theme. The textbooks embrace local Christians in Jordan, ethnic minorities and foreigners. Atheists and idolaters have rights. This is really interesting. The traditional Islamic view of polytheism is really not a tolerant one. And yet we saw tolerance in the changes in the Jordanian curriculum. It is not perfect in relation to how Israel is perceived, as we would expect from the Jordanians. A cursory mention of the peace treaty with Israel. We really do believe that Jordanian children need to be educated as to the fact that there is a peace agreement between Israel and Jordan, and there is just not enough there. Israel is still described as a Zionist entity, but in Islamic studies, which is so important in relation to that curriculum, you know, we have seen some changes which are impressive and worthy of talking about. The jewel in the crown in relation to positive change is the United Arab Emirates. We have just produced our report, and this is a remarkable school curriculum. Prosperity, national pride in this curriculum are very much associated with peace and tolerance. Engagement and cooperation with non-nationals, non-Emiratis is lauded. They offer a realistic approach to peace and security. They do teach patriotism, but they are powerfully anti-radical, commitment to defending the homeland, but cooperating with allies. Peacemaking, absolutely the priority in this curriculum. But I think, you know, the biggest takeaway is the large Islamic education program is all about tolerance, about coexistence, about friendly relations with non-Muslims and other ethnicities. They're not blaming foreigners, as so many textbooks in the Middle East do. The Abraham Accords are actually taught in the UAE curriculum. The change was made about a month after they were signed. And they are supported both on a national level, i.e. it is good for the country, but also on a religious level. A religious scholar is brought in to explain that Islam is a religion of peace. It is a bridge between religions, and therefore the Accords make perfect sense. So, you know, Israel isn't displayed on maps, which is odd. We will be engaging and we hope changes there will be made. But generally, it is without a shadow of a doubt, head and shoulders above all other curricula in the region. The Qatari curriculum is, I think, fair to say, in a phase of transformation. And Alan, of course, we work together on this. So, you know, we saw a curriculum which is somewhat less radical than previous versions. There is a process of moderation, but really in its infancy. And, you know, we are pushing to a greater extent than we have seen before for positive change. We think there is no room for anti-Semitism in any school curriculum, certainly not in the Middle East, and the Qataris need to do everything that is required in order to make those changes. There were passages there that demonize Jews. They're praising martyrdom. They blame the holy faiths for corrupting, you know, texts. This needs to go. Something like a third of this material is out. We want to see it all out and working on that. I will speak a little bit about Israeli textbooks. We're coming out with a large report fairly soon. And the big takeaway with Israeli textbooks has always been the identification of peace as the ultimate goal, as highly desirable, but achievable, practically achievable. That is something which I think we've seen, you know, really from the genesis of the writing of the Israeli curriculum. But where we see more and more positive change in relation to content is the acknowledgement of not just Palestinian presence pre-1948, but the Palestinian national identity, different aspects of Palestinian narrative experience. For those who might have, you know, a grasp of Hebrew, or Arabic, the word Nakba is used. Hebrew, the word Gerush is used. The first word is the Palestinian view of 1948 as a disaster. The second is a Hebrew word which, you know, talks about, you know, expulsion in 1948. There is Israeli Jewish school children are given a Palestinian perspective of what happened in 1948. Of course, they are given other perspectives as well, but they are given that perspective. And of course, the individualization of Israeli Arabs is a major part of the Israeli curriculum. And so Israeli Arabs are shown in their families, in their workplaces, as doctors, as lawyers, playing as children do, so that Israeli children are Jewish, can relate to, you know, Israeli Arab to Palestinian children. They do recognize in maps the physical presence of Palestinians and Palestinian cities, certainly in political maps. In topographical graphs, you know, may not so much, but then they never do. I think generally, though, it is a curriculum which explains the complexities. They explain the political disagreements within Israeli society, but they maintain a clear message of tolerance and of coexistence with the Arab and Muslim minorities and towards Palestinian Israeli citizens in particular. The ultra-Orthodox textbooks are not to the same level. Now, it's a complicated set of textbooks because, you know, to a great extent, many of these children are not actually studying in textbooks at all in schools. They're studying, you know, the Talmud. And this in and of itself is a problem. Girls more than boys are studying, if you like, non-religious subjects. But the textbooks do not incite by any stretch of the imagination, but they are in need of reform. They need updating. You know, they create an idea of, you know, everything we know about the ultra-Orthodox community, a community which has built walls around it. Everything within the wall is good. Everything outside of the wall is threatening, essentially. And that is to a great extent in these textbooks, non-ultra-Orthodox Israelis, even ultra-Orthodox Israelis who have, if you like, breached the other side of the wall. So, you know, they need reform. We are talking to the Israeli Ministry of Education about that. You know, generally, though, it is that they are so antiquated, which is the problem with the textbooks. All is not rosy in relation to MENA textbooks. I think you're not going to be at all surprised to hear that Iranian textbooks demonize Jews. They glorify terror. Iranian youth are frankly raised to follow in the footsteps of what are thousands of children who were killed or made invalid during Iran's war with Iraq. And so there are role models there of children who walked across minefields. You know, these are heroes. These are shahidim. These are people who, you know, these Iranian children should emulate. There is a clear ambition there of Iranian hegemony in the textbooks, a culture of militarism, of jihad, blind obedience to the Ayatollah, paranoia, hostility towards the rest of the world. You know, very much a Manchean division of the world, good and evil. And it is very clear who is good and who is evil. By the way, you should know, the scientific education of the Iranian textbooks is really good. Now, so what you might end up with is children who will make the perfect nuclear scientist, right? They have the scientific education, and they have also been brought up to be told exactly how this should be used. It is actually, a little bit frightening. The Turkish curriculum, which again, Alan, we worked together on, you know, I think that is, something which is particularly problematic because it has got worse over the last few years. It did radicalize, and that's a cause for worry. Jihad war was introduced as a value in what is a secular curriculum, a curriculum, you know, which finds its roots in Ataturk than it does in any Islamic strain of thought in Turkey. There is with that an ethno-nationalist religious vision. So you have neo-Ottomanism and pan-Turkism working together and taught together. And so, you know, ideas of Turkish world domination, you know, this is a phrase in the textbooks. And the Ottoman Empire, in the same way that the Iranians are obsessed by the Persian Empire, so the Turks are obsessed by the glories of the Ottoman Empire. These imperial dreams, I think we see those parallels with Turkey and with Iran. Very anti-American, the Turkish textbooks. They are, you know, simpatico for the motivations of ISIS and Al-Qaeda. Christians and Jews are now infidels, not people of the book. And that is an important difference. We hope that swings back, but that is, you know, absolutely not a positive change over the last few years. There was a demonization of Zionism, verging on anti-Semitic messaging, in describing some post-First World War Jewish schools as hostile to Turkish independence. So essentially what you're saying is, you know, the Jews were fifth columnists and against Turkish independence. Interestingly, though, they teach the Holocaust, they teach the Shoah. And so, you know, that might be a bit of a holdout from before the changes in the curriculum, but we are happy to see that, and that is something which is worthy of mentioning. I think just, Alan, I will just briefly talk about the Palestinian textbooks. I know that has, you know, been such a topic of conversation in the UK, and I'll just say the following. They were totally reformed in 2016, but with the Turkish curriculum, they are the only other example of textbooks which got worse over the last few years. So in the new reformed Palestinian curriculum, and just before I go into that, also worth noting, they are the only school authority in the Middle East which is entirely supported by donor countries. The Palestinian Authority's Ministry of Education's employees, i.e. teachers, are supported by, to a great extent, by the European Union and in bilateral relations with the European countries as well. No more by the UK and not by the US. So in the reformed curriculum, Firstly, peace is just not presented as possible. It is not only not preferred, it is not even possible. Peace agreements and proposals with Israel, which did appear, have been taken out. They are simply not in the textbooks anymore. There was a cursory mention of the Oslo Accords as something which was disastrous and should never be allowed to happen again. So the question is, what's in its place? Anti-Semitic canards. Jews are corrupt. They are doomed to annihilation. They control finance, the media, politics, all these old anti-Semitic tropes. They are the enemies of Islam. They are sinful liars and fraudsters. And I use these phrases as direct quotes from the Palestinian curriculum. Well-known anti-Semites are heroes in this textbook. Science is used to radicalize children. So Newton's second law is taught through the use of slingshot, targeting soldiers. Maths is taught by adding up martyrs. How many martyrs in the first intifada? How many in the second? Add them up. This is not, you know, your apples and pears mathematics. The Munich Olympic massacre, and you can imagine how Germans feel about this. The Munich Olympic massacre is endorsed as, you know, a legitimate act of defense. Terrorists such as Dalal Mughrabi, who led the 1978 Coastal Road massacre, which killed 38 Israelis, including 13 children, are glorified as role models, as heroes to be emulated. In fact, girls in particular are told to glorify Dalal Mughrabi. And she appears in that textbook 4-5 times. Even, you know, Arabic language is used in order to radicalize. There's a reading exercise for first graders, which teaches the letter ha, the Arabic letter ha, as an example, using the word shaheed, martyr, hujum, attack. And this is, you know, what, six-year-old kids, this is how they are learning language. And, you know, jihad is a central part of this curriculum for the liberation of Palestine. It's an obligation, they are told, for every Muslim. You know, I could go on. But, you know, I think we know how problematic the Palestinian curriculum is. The international community are all over this. It has been a big issue in the UK. It is in the EU as well. It was raised in the United Nations. It is being discussed now in Congress. HR 2374 is all about this issue. And, you know, I'm not sure, and we can talk about it, whether there is a possibility of changing it. But while it exists, there is absolutely no justification whatsoever for donor countries to be complicit in this. Just the last thing I'll say, Alan, I think we have a real opportunity. The Abraham Accords have presented us with really an unprecedented moment in time in order to change curricula in the region. And I think we all need to seize that and to create those tolerant, peaceful societies of the future, which, you know, we think are well within our grasp. So I'll just end there and thank you.
Thank you. Wow. I mean, there's a lot. I mean, packed a lot in there, Marcus. I mean, you know, we've got so many different avenues to go down. Let me just start with a basic question, though. Do you sort of run a league table at all of these curricula? And if so, who would? I know you mentioned, you know, UAE's top, but who would be in your top three and who would be in your bottom three? I think we guessed bottom three from your last couple. It'd be interesting to see how you'd rank it if you don't do it already.
So the answer is we don't. It has been suggested to us that we do. What we do is because we're comparing the curricula against standards rather than, you know, against each other. We, you know, we do feel that empirically we get more out of it that way. Having said that, I think there are, you know, really very good reasons that there, you know, there should be some kind of appreciation of who is doing well and who isn't. If not, because, you know, it encourages the others. And, you know, in relation to, you know, who is on the top, you know, clearly the Israeli curriculum, you know, in relation to the Middle East is absolutely there. But put that aside for the moment, it is the UAE. And, you know, it's for a couple of reasons, actually. The first is because of what is in the books because of how successful it is in bringing together in all subjects those ideas of peace, of tolerance, of relating national identity to and success to tolerance of others. But I think the other element of it is how it came about in the first place. And it was in the same way that the Palestinian Authority is utterly strategic in radicalizing 1.3 million children every school day. It is absolutely strategic that this curriculum was put together. Mohammed Ben Ziad, the Crown Prince, went about making these changes. He, post 9/11, he absolutely internalized the, you know, the possibility of you know, radicalization in his own country, what it could mean. He spent a lot of time thinking about what changes need to be made. Education was very much top of his agenda, and within that, textbooks, for the reasons we discussed, because they are so authoritative. And so, you know, they were originally written by the Muslim Brotherhood in the UAE, as so many textbooks are, by the way, in the region, and also taught by the Muslim Brotherhood. So not only did he have them rewritten, but he made sure that the Muslim Brothers were no longer teaching them. So essentially, you know, he got rid of those teachers. You know, all of this is you know, kind of on the record, and he's very clear about this. But the result is extremely sophisticated. It is extremely well thought out. And, you know, they would absolutely be on the top of the league. You know, there is a big gap, frankly, between the UAE and other countries. You know, as I mentioned, you know, I do believe that King Abdullah II deserves a great deal of praise for those changes he made in the Islamic studies part of the curriculum, because it was so poor beforehand, and because he understood how important that, you know, in the Middle East, you know, Islamic studies is not just another course, if you like. It tends to be, you know, quite a big chunk of the coursework. In Saudi Arabia, at one point, it was bigger, more than a third of the whole school curriculum was Islamic studies. It's shrunk somewhat, but, and you know, this is not just, if you like, as I say, another piece of coursework. And so he homed in on that. And, you know, he did that thing which all leaders can do, which is he made choices. You know, he picked the surahs, which is, you know, the text within the Quran, and the hadiths, which is, if you like, a kind of commentary. And, you know, he made the choices as to the surahs and hadiths, which are tolerant, which talk about, you know, peacemaking, which talk about acceptance.
He personally did this?
He made it happen. Let's put it that way. You know, our understanding was he did have, you know, quite a bit of hands-on involvement. But, you know, I doubt that he was, you know, going through the curriculum page by page himself and making those changes, but he was certainly made it very clear what he wanted to see and, you know, what the end result should look like. And, you know, he did that, you know, for reasons we understand. He did that because, you know, he was worried about radicalization of Jordanian children. You know, by the time you know, ISIS was rampant, of course he was terrified of Jordanian young Jordanians joining ISIS. You know, the refugee issue and the amount of refugees which Jordan has accepted means that they themselves are studying the Jordanian curriculum as refugees do in the countries which they end up in. And, you know, this was another element which, you know, he understood to be important as to, you know, not having radicals inside of his own territory. So, you know, these reasons for him, they were very internal. You know, these were reasons very much related to, you know, to security within Jordan. And, you know, as I say, more needs to be done. More changes need to be made. Israel needs to be associated with a peace treaty with Jordan. Jordanian children need to understand this. And there is really that one mention of the peace agreement. there needs to be an explanation of it. There needs to be exercises associated with it for Jordanian children to delve into. It is important for them to know this. You know, there is a high level of anti-Israel sentiment in Jordan. All the public opinion research, which we have all seen, points to Jordan as one of the most anti-Israel countries in the region. And that needs to be changed and changed through the textbooks. So that's the next stage. We do not expect the Jordanians not to, you know, have the views that they have on Palestinian nationalism. They absolutely, you know, are entitled to that, but it needs to be done within those UNESCO standards of peace and tolerance. And, you know, Jerusalem is clearly an issue for the Jordanians, but again, you know, Jerusalem can be talked about without incitement. And to have a piece in the textbook, which they do, of you know, the Jews digging under Al-Aqsa and essentially the Al-Aqsa Mosque being in danger, that is such an incendiary you know, element to have in a textbook. And by the way, it runs the whole way through the Middle East. But we really don't need to see that in Jordan.
Yes, that's a strange, yeah, kind of, it sits oddly with some of the other things that you've mentioned. Curious that there are these sort of dualities. You've got some very good points and then, of course, some very bad points, you know, juxtaposed with each other. Again, lots of places we can go with this. Let's just take Israel for a second, because obviously, look, Israel stands on its own as a democracy. You'd expect it to top the league table, obviously. You've highlighted all some flaws. I suppose one question is simply, how does the education ministry, how far does its writ actually run? I mean, you mentioned, for example, these ultra-Orthodox textbooks that are very different to, say, secular Israeli textbooks. I'm sure, what would happen, say, in an Arab Israeli village? Would that be a different textbook again? How does this work exactly? And how much power does the Central Education Ministry have?
So a really good question. Extraordinarily complicated, because I'm Israel, sure. And, yes. And so it is. The answer to the question is actually not so much. There is, textbooks are being written in Israel entirely out of sync with Israeli governments, which means that even when there isn't, you know, four elections in 2 years or whatever, in a period of, you know, of a party ruling for some time, the Likud party, when, you know, Benjamin Netanyahu was prime minister, and for 5 years of that, if I'm not mistaken, Naftali Bennett was minister of education, the most liberal textbook of all was written, the civics education textbook, which is the one where, you know, as I mentioned, the Nakba is discussed. And so, you know, that is the clearest indication one can have that there is a disconnect between the Israeli Ministry of Education and its textbooks. They are written by an organization called Matach, based in Tel Aviv University, by, you know, generally by liberal academics. But what they do is have a list of approved textbooks. Now, how much they actually delve into what is in those textbooks is a good question. But if you go to the Israeli Ministry of Education website, there is a long list of those textbooks. So you have, if you like, these two things happening at once. You have educational / civil society creating textbooks, and publishers then asking for approval of the Israeli Ministry of Education. And you have Israeli governments, you know, standing up in the Knesset and making statements about, you know, about education, which might bear absolutely no relevance to what is happening in Israeli classrooms. But the in relation to the actual setup, so you have the state sector, which is, you know, Israel basically is a public school sector. You know, there's a tiny private educational sector. So the vast majority of kids go to public schools. The majority of those are secular, or state, as they are called, mamlachti in Hebrew. You then have state religious, which are pretty much like the state, but they get extra lessons. And then you have, as you alluded to, you have the Arabic, the best way of calling it really is Arabic language schools. And these can also be broken up into, you know, Muslim, Christian, Druze. Now, mainly they are studying the same curriculum as Jewish students in Israel, because, you know, ultimately they are going to be sitting for the same exams, what is called the bagrut, the matriculation. So, you know, they're studying the same courses. Slight, you know, obviously differences for any, you know, religious education. We are actually doing a bit of research now into the Israeli Arab textbooks to see how much difference there might be. But they, you know, it's more about language than it is about anything else. And then, of course, the ultra-religious. And that one is the one which is the most problematic, apart from anything else, because it's barely regulated. You know, school inspectors are just not going in and out of those schools. And, you know, as I said, the books are antiquated, problematic, in need of reform. The latest news, by the way, is quite positive. One of the largest Hasidic sect of the in that sector, what, you know, the belts, as they are known, seem to have accepted the idea that they will begin teaching the core curriculum, i.e. maths, English, one or two other subjects, which in 2022 shouldn't be such, you know, a great triumph, but there it is. And, you know, we'll also be pushing that they will be, you know, they'll be learning values as well. So really then you have those four sectors, don't you? You have state religious, Arabic language and ultra religious. And, you know, again, what they all have in common is, you know, clearly not inciting, and the vast majority of them really do have, you know, those high standards of peacemaking as a way to resolve conflict, of respect for the individual other. You know, by the way, they shouldn't be taken as read. You know, Israeli children are in a conflict zone. And, you know, especially if they are in the south of Israel, if they are, you know, close to, or even not so close to the Gaza border, they might on one hand, you know, spend their nights in shelters when Hamas is bombing them, and then, you know, wake up the next morning and they're, you know, learning about the, you know, the Palestinian other and, you know, respecting the Palestinian other. So, you know, this is, I think, something which, you know, one should be taking note of.
To follow up with one last Israeli question, how are complicated subjects like settlements mentioned in Israeli textbooks?
So the answer is that they are. Children get an array of views within textbooks. So they are told, you know, some consider this to be an illegal occupation. Some consider this to be, you know, rightfully part of Israel. There have been, you know, negotiations. Those negotiations had X and Y result. You know, this is not, they're clearly told, you know, this is not part of Israel. You know, this is not annexed territory. And so they are, you know, they are given a good perspective on different views within Israel, and left to make up their own minds, essentially. But yes, you know, settlements are mentioned. You know, it gets, there is a level of, there was one history textbook which explains to children about an elderly Palestinian man at a checkpoint. And, you know, you are an Israeli soldier, and, you know, feel empathy and imagine, you know, what this is like and understand the situation. So, you know, there is that kind of material as well inside of Israeli textbooks.
Okay, interesting. You get then that multiplicity of views. Let's look at the Palestinian Authority for a second. I mean, is there a difference between what goes on in Gaza and what goes on in the West Bank?
None whatsoever.
Interesting. So the textbooks are the same, the donors are the same.
So the textbooks are the same textbooks. And if you think about that for a moment, that is really quite singular. There are not many areas of life where Hamas absolutely embrace anything coming out of Ramallah. Ramallah, of course, you know, the Palestinian Authority, Hamas, you know, governing Gaza, and yet they entirely accept the textbooks, which, you know, leads one to the view that they really are radical if they are so acceptable to Hamas. They do not change Hamas a word of the textbooks which are taught in those schools. And by the way, in parallel, you have UNRWA. So of those, you know, 1.3 million Palestinian children in schools in the West Bank and Gaza, you have 360,000 now in UNRWA schools learning identical textbooks.
Interesting. Okay, so that, so these are across the board. Why do you? I mean, obviously, this we know, we've discussed this before. Of course, subject to donors and understanding how your money goes on some of these products. Why is there this reticence among donors to exert their rights as donors to actually take a, you know, look at improving that curriculum? Why is that not happening? Everyone knows what goes on in these textbooks. So why is this an issue that still requires, you know, you to bang on people's doors to tell them and to shame them finally taking action? I've never understood the rationale for this. It's all obvious. You've got the evidence. So why are people not taking it seriously?
I think they are taking it seriously. And, you know, by the way, I think the UK is a very good example of that. You know, whatever reason might be given for, you know, stopping that aid to the PA and halving the aid to UNRWA, you know, the textbook element, absolutely a part of that. The British government had been hearing time and time and time again about the fact that British taxpayers were, you know, paying to radicalize Palestinian children. And an element of that, you know, clearly sunk in. The European Parliament has condemned the Palestinian Authority / UNRWA 4 times now for teaching hate. Now, I get your point, Alan. There is a gap between, you know, standing on your hind legs and condemning and saying, hey, but hold on, you know, our Pagasse fund, which is close to a billion euro, well, if the majority of that is going to education, let's say, you know, 600 million euro, then, you know, money talks, right? And so, you know, that should be absolutely the point at which, you know, the Europeans say, this is what is on the line. I think it's fair to say that we are moving into that point now, that it is transcended or moved up from the level of the European Parliament. It's moved into the Commission and the European Council as well. I think Commissioner Vaheli, who is in charge of the Pagasse Fund, in charge of everything in relation to the EU and the Palestinian Authority, you know, has serious intentions in relation to some kind of reserve being put on the Palestinian Authority. You know, we're not talking about freezing all that amount of money, but we are talking about a reserve. We know that because, you know, we are active and we are involved in what is going on in Brussels at the moment in relation to this. But you know, following the Palestinian Authority's statements on this, we also know that they are not just aware of this, but in the way that they do, absolutely resisting it. It's all about the EU. You know, by far the greatest donors are the EU. They have the power to change these textbooks. They have the power to make sure that these children aren't radicalized. And, you know, it's a bizarre situation. On one hand, the EU says it is in the game, the donor game, the game of supporting the Palestinian Authority, so that you know, there is a possibility of peace down the line, and they must maintain the Palestinian Authority so that will happen. On the other hand, they are absolutely complicit in making sure that there is not one child in the Palestinian Authority who has the faintest clue what peace actually means, what it looks like, what a two-state solution might possibly look like if that was, you know, on the horizon. So, you know, they're absolutely shooting themselves in the foot.
Well, they are, but unfortunately, that sort of, you know, appears to be par for the course. It still surprises though with the EU. Staying with Palestinian education, there is a House Resolution 2374, the Palestinian Education Peace and Tolerance Act. Is that something you're familiar with?
Intimately, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Do you believe that requires, I mean, there's only a reporting function there. Do you believe it requires things like sanctions in order to be effective? And it, if not, or if so, even what would you add to it to make it more meaningful?
So, you know, it is a resolution initially tabled by Brad Sherman, Lee Zeldin. It is gaining, you know, quite a lot of bipartisan support. It's moving through HFAC, the House Foreign Affairs Committee, as we speak. The Senate is beginning to move on it. And yes, you're absolutely right. It does not have a direct financial element to it. But it does ask that US aid is not used to inciting textbooks. At the moment, that is not happening because for all the reasons that you know, the US does not directly fund the Palestinian Authority. And so, you know, in a sense, it's a moot point. As the US is not, you know, directly involved with funding the PA, HR 2374 doesn't necessarily have to, you know, have to stipulate that. I think much more important, though, is the UNRWA element. And the US, as you know, got back involved in funding UNRWA in this administration. They are now up to $400 million in direct aid to UNRWA, which is something like about 40% of all UNRWA aid. Now, if the majority of that goes to education, so that's what, 22-23% of UNRWA's education budget is coming directly from the US. So there is the point where there is much that the US can and should do about that. Now, that is happening very much on the administration level. The State Department is acutely aware of this issue. You know, we briefed them, you know, even before this administration came in during the, you know, during the period just before it came in, we started briefing them on the issue. And, you know, that led to Secretary of State Blinken saying to the House and the Senate that he realizes there is a problem. There is, I think the phrase he used was problematic material in the PA curriculum, but he was reported also to refer to not in the House and Senate, but in a moment to talk about anti-Semitism in the curriculum, that it is unacceptable. And that, you know, they essentially, you know, will be taking action if change isn't made. And so we will be, you know, making sure that they are educated as to the fact that, you know, change hasn't been made. And by the way, just on that subject, there was a moment in the summer of 2021 where it was felt in Europe, certainly, that, you know, the PA was going to do this. It was going to change its curriculum. There was a report, as you know, the George Eckhart report, which came out, which inevitably, you know, found what we all knew for years and years. But of course, the EU had to do its own report to find it. And that was, there was anti-Semitism and incitement to violence in the Palestinian Authority's curriculum, and therefore in what UNRWA teaches as well. And a roadmap was developed between the European Union and between the Palestinian Authority to make changes. So we reviewed the curriculum of September 2021. They took the 2020 books and reprinted them, but changed the date. Not even a smidgen of an effort to make any changes whatsoever. And not only, unfortunately, it gets worse. I do like to talk about the good things, but not with the PA, because unfortunately there aren't any. It got worse. They, in parallel, printed a set of material, something like 10,000 pages of what they call study cards, which is even worse than the PA curriculum, because some of it actually directly incites to violence. So this is what they did immediately after agreeing with the European Union that they are going to make the changes. So no wonder Mr. Barhelli is furious, and no wonder he doesn't want to be financing this anymore. The PA have made it very clear publicly they're not going to make changes, but I think, you know, if you want to delve just one level down into why, I think for them it's just strategic. I think this is, you know, more than just a set of textbooks to them. This is absolutely a you know, it's a policy. It is a strategy to make sure that Palestinian society will maintain a level of radicalization, a level of what they call resistance, which is the absolute antithesis of the possibility of peace. And understanding that, I think you understand everything one needs to know about what is going on, not just with PA textbooks, but with the PA itself.
And that's obviously a very sad story, and hopefully something can be done about that. But let's look at that success story, UAE, for a second, in your view. Now, presumably, 10 years ago, the UAE was not that much of a success story. What, you know, it's changed a lot. Or has it? Is it a case that it was always actually pretty good apart from certain bits and pieces? I just get a sense of that, because I want to ask a follow-up to that. So do you want to just give me a sense of how it has changed in, say, 10 years?
I mean, it's changed radically in 10 years. the, you know, in obviously many aspects, and the textbooks, you know, give us a really good insight into that. I think it's changed because Mohammed bin Ziyad, the crown prince, has been driving this. He has a vision, I mean, literally a vision. It's Vision 2030. As the Saudis have a Vision 2030, so do the Emiratis. And it is a vision of, you know, what the United Arab Emirates should be. And it is a society which is not going to be dependent on fossil fuels, on oil and on gas, but will be open, trading with the rest of the world, a population which is happy. I know that sounds bizarre, but the idea of happiness is also very much a part of the UAE curriculum. And it's something we take note of in the same way, again, that the PA curriculum is so, you know, dark and sinister. The UAE curriculum is, you know, clearly talks to young people about the importance of happiness and these ideas of happiness and peacefulness and tolerance and openness and respect for others, you know, all, if you like, come together into a vision of the creation of a society which takes its place on the international stage, while maintaining, as it should, you know, its religious beliefs, while maintaining its national identity. But everything it does in a spirit of tolerance, of cooperation, and of acceptance of the other. So absolutely, totally different to the country which, you know, the country, the United Arab Emirates of, if you like, you know, the beginning of the 2000s, yes.
Right. And before I ask my follow-up, if anyone wants to ask any last question, please put it in. I've been weaving in your questions to my comments. But the follow-up would be basically, so a change of that nature, of that magnitude, have we got any evidence about how it's been received? So, for example, you know, you start teaching different things to what, you know, has been taught for many years, people are going to normally have a reaction to that. Now, I know, obviously, the UAE is not a democracy. We all understand that. You know, we all get that sort of point. But realistically, there must have been some pushback in some way, people going, well, these are crazy ideas. Have you any evidence of that? How was that managed? What was the sort of process there? Mm.
Well, you know, of course, it's a different society. And so, you know, in relation to civil society pushback, that's always going to be, you know, different to what, you know, one might be used to in the West. But, you know, the pushback always tends to be from Muslim Brotherhood associated organizations. They have been laser focused on education. You know, very much in the style of give me a child, you know, at six and they're mine for life. That has, you know, been their philosophy. I have no indication of any pushback in the UAE. However, there is, you know, definitely anecdotal evidence that parents always like these positive reforms. I'll just give you one very interesting example. Okay. So just very brief example, the Al-Sisi made a change to a history geography textbook where for the first time, Egyptian children were taught about a warm peace with Israel, not just peace, and how that is good for Egypt. And Al Jazeera, being Al Jazeera and hating Al-Sisi, jumped on our report on this textbook and did a 1-hour live program about how, you know, terrible Al-Sisi is because, you know, he's teaching children about, you know, how peacefulness is a good thing. Now, two Egyptian parents phoned in and they actually took on the host on this live Al Jazeera show and said, listen, this is what we want. You know, we want our children to be happy and to be successful. We don't want our children to be radicalized. You know, our takeaway from that is, you know, there must be within, you know, all societies, you know, parents want their children to be happy, to be successful, to be peaceful, to live in peace, and certainly not to be cannon fodder, and not to be used by authorities in order to, you know, put themselves in danger in front of troops or whatever. And, you know, one would like to believe, entirely anecdotal, and we are, you know, we are an empirical organization, so you'll have to excuse me, but, you know, one has to believe that this is what parents in the Middle East want as much as parents, you know, everywhere in the world want.
Then I've got to play devil's advocate with you as my last question, my lord. You've just said, you know, parents don't want this, basically. But those parents presumably would have also have gone through radicalized teaching and radicalized education. Does that essentially mean that all this is essentially a sideshow and people end up being normal after all?
I mean, you know, really, really interesting question. You know, we can only take what we can take from, you know, people writing in sociology and education about, you know, the power that textbooks have to create those societies and how they can be, you know, how they can act as a barrier. You know, I do think that, you know, ultimately, yes, of course, there are going to be, you know, parents who are, as you say, you know, radicalized. So they, you know, they might have a problem with that. But there is one more, you know, I met somebody from the security services of a certain country who was, you know, talking about their meeting with the leader of a terror organization, essentially. And this person, on one hand, was the leader of a terror organization, but on the other hand, sent his child to through an education, which was, you know, if you like, the education of the occupier. And when asked why, he said, listen, you know, I have two parts of my head. On one hand, you know, I have a certain ideology that I believe in. On the other hand, I want my kid to be a successful lawyer. And so, you know, it could be that, you know, people can make this separation, that people can, you know, on one hand, have the education they were educated into, and on the other hand, you know, understand they want better from their children. So maybe in the next generation, their children won't have that other half, that radicalized half. Who knows?
That is an interesting idea of the sort of responsible terrorist. But OK, I will happily buy that in that way. Marcus, really?
I think maybe.
Go on. You think maybe?
I was just going to say, I wonder if he was a responsible terrorist, maybe just a self-interested terrorist.
A self-interested terrorist. Well, that's also, some may say, an improvement. thank you. It's been a fascinating hour, really. We've delved into some very interesting topics, looking at the, you know, obviously the sort of improving pack, the places where there still needs to be focus, some of those issues. It's clear the work that you do is fascinating from, as you said, an empirical point of view, but also a standards point of view. Although I gave you my, you know, kind of my devil's advocate at the end, obviously it's a bit of a straw man argument, because obviously you don't want to have people being taught you know, radical, you know, and extreme ideas, because even if one or two people take them on as being real, that has real life repercussions, obviously, for them and indeed for anyone who, you know, comes into contact with them as well. So, you know, thank you for your work. Thank you for, you know, having given us the benefit of your insights. Thank you all for joining us as well. There's a lot on, obviously, this week with Ukraine and Russia. We've got some events coming up. There's one that you'll get shortly. For an event on Thursday, quite a big panel event on Russia and Ukraine. We hope you can all join us for that. Marcus, thank you, and keep up the good work, everyone, and we'll see you all soon. Thank you.